بعد از مذاکرات 5 کشور قدرتمند جهان با ایران در ژنو، امیدواری برای حل مسائلی که کشورهای غربی حول برنامه‌های هسته‌ای ایران دارند بیشتر شد. ولی امیدواری برای آینده درازمدت‌تر روابط این کشورها با ایران در چه حدی است؟ مهمان من نظرات مشخصی در این باره دارد. او در برهه مهمی از تحولات سیاسی ایران نماینده کشورش در تهران بود. Sir Richard Dalton, welcome to Be'ebarat-e Digar.
Thank you.
Sir Richard, ever since you've come back from Tehran, you've been an advocate of the realistic and creative engagement with Iran. What's happening now? Do you see that kind of creativeness and engagement at the moment?
I'm not going to give you a direct answer, because the fact is we don't know. Certainly, an encouraging start has been made, but it looks to me as though Iran is willing to explore the position of the countries it is negotiating with step by step. So if there has been one meeting that went well, it does not mean that the future meetings will also go well. Whether they do or not depends on decisions which have not yet been taken either in Tehran or maybe even in Washington as well.
But what exactly did you mean when you suggested all this creative and realistic approach or engagement with Iran? What do you mean?
What I mean is that there should be two main ways in which the international community engages with Iran. The first is to discuss with Iran the fact that it must bring its interaction with the International Atomic Energy Agency into full conformity with international law. Iran wishes at the moment to be the judge and jury in its own case, but no country, including my own, is judge and jury of its own case in the International Atomic Energy Agency and in the Security Council. So there are serious questions to create confidence in Iran's intentions, which Iran cannot avoid. And one of my reasons for saying that I don't know whether future rounds of discussion will go well is I don't know whether Iran is yet prepared to address questions about military dimensions of research and development in its nuclear program, or whether it is prepared to accept the basic standard of safeguards for its civil nuclear program, which all countries are being asked to adopt, particularly countries with as significant a program as Iran's, and that is the additional protocol to Iran's safeguards agreement.
What if Iran's not prepared for all these things that you're saying?
Well, the other part of the way in which people should engage with Iran is to seek mutual benefit. There are regional problems in Iraq and Afghanistan, in the fight against drug addiction and drug smuggling. There is the question of making the region of the Persian Gulf safer and more stable in the long term through international cooperation. There are the disagreements between Iran and most other countries on how to progress the trouble between the Palestinians and Israelis, whether there should be support for violent solutions to that dispute, or whether there should be wholehearted support for a peaceful settlement. All these matters need to be on the table, together with Iran's difficulties with the United States, with the history of disagreement, of distrust between the world's single superpower and Iran. Those matters cannot stay out of the debate if there is to be a successful resolution of all these questions. So Iran has a legitimate point of view. Iran has reason to be concerned about the security of its territory. And that must be part of the negotiation.
But one of those legitimate views or rights that the Iranian are advocating is that enriching uranium and also having nuclear energy programs is the rights of Iranians, and it cannot be violated by anyone. Is that part of that realistic approach that you suggested?
That is Iran's right. But that right is not absolute. It is based on responsibilities as well. And Iran has breached its responsibilities to the international community by not answering satisfactorily the entirely legitimate questions of the International Atomic Energy Agency about possible military dimensions to its research and development in the nuclear sphere, and by not adhering to the terms of the additional protocol to its safeguards agreement. Yes, it is a voluntary measure, but the world has a right, given the history of this question, to ask Iran to adopt the additional protocol in all its aspects without hesitation. So, yes, Iran has the right to an enrichment program, provided that it is covered by the same international arrangements that other countries submit to ensure that the world stays safe against the proliferation of nuclear weapons.
So now the negotiation that is started in Geneva, and it seems that it's going to carry on for a while. How hopeful are you that it's come to some sort of acceptable agreement to both sides?
Decisions have to be taken in Iran for me to be able to say, yes, I'm hopeful.
But do you see any signs?
One of them is that Iran should engage seriously. We've seen a preliminary suggestion that Iran might do that. Secondly, we have to have a decision in Tehran that the interests of the country are bound up in success in this negotiation, and achieving success quite quickly over the next few months. In the past, we have seen use of negotiations to delay the moment at which a decision has to be taken about which fork in the road to choose, the fork leading to cooperation or the fork that leads to confrontation. And on this occasion, it's not going to be possible to delay matters. The international community has a right to ask Iran, such is the seriousness of this question, to proceed at some speed. And we don't know yet whether Iran is prepared
but
to do that.
The Iranians have already actually accepted the two very important concessions. One is that they are going to send the uranium for further enrichment to Russia and then later to France. And the other one is to give access to the monitors of the IAEA to visit the Qom installment. So that aren't they enough for a beginning of a very positive and constructive negotiation?
Well, let us hope so. Mm-hmm. But one swallow does not make a summer. Iran had announced before the talks in Geneva that it would be willing to let the inspectors visit the new facility in Qom. And that was the very least that they could do, given that they were in breach of the IAEA's requirement that Iran should notify the IAEA about the start to the construction of a new facility. Now, this is a matter that's in dispute, but that is the view of the International Atomic Energy Agency. So the very least Iran could do was to let the inspectors in. So I don't see this as indicating that Iran has taken a decision to move stage by stage ahead to reach a satisfactory conclusion to this long-running dispute.
But the fact that this time the Iranians are directly engaging with the Americans, and also we've heard a very positive response from the Americans, from the French, and from British, that has been a very constructive engagement so far.
Yes, it has been constructive, and I personally welcome the moves that Iran has made. They've got these talks off to a good start.
Yeah, but do you see, I mean, you know the Iranians, you have dealt with them, with the Iranian politicians, you lived in Iran, and do you see that the change of heart by the Iranians? I mean, do you do you envisage something that it never happened before?
I think one could answer that question and say, yes, we see a change of heart. If we see some new proposals from the Iranian side, the Iranians don't like the proposals that have been submitted to them over a number of years by the people they are talking to. Fine, well then, it's up to the Iranians to come up with something better, because they know that simply trying to keep the international community at arm's length and not acceding to justified requests, like on the additional protocol, like on answering questions about the military dimensions, they know perfectly well that that's not acceptable. So it is up to the Iranians to come forward with some fresh ideas if they don't like the ideas that they have received hitherto from the six countries.
Why don't the West accept the words of Ayatollah Khamenei when he says that it's against our religion, basically, is some sort of an edict that to have a nuclear weapon? I mean, he's the highest authority in Iran, and also he is a religious person.
Well, I believe that that Britain respects the word of Ayatollah Khamenei and wishes to take it into account. But there's something to be said, too, for verifying the word of the leader of another country. And that is what would happen in any other situation. In the course of disarmament negotiations, arms limitation negotiations between the United States and Russia, the slogan was always trust and verify, because the international community always wants to know that a leader's promises are being carried out in practice. And it is legitimate to ask Iran to cooperate in verifying the truth of what it asserts, particularly given the history over the last 20 years of secret aspects of what Iran has been doing.
One of the issues with the Iranians that they've been very vociferous about that, or at least in public, I don't know whether it is part of their condition in negotiating with the Western countries, is the situation with Israel. They say that the Israelis have arsenal, a nuclear arsenal, and it doesn't seem anybody in the West is bothered, whereas they are constantly pressurizing Iran not have even nuclear energy. So if, yes. Do you think, I mean, that kind of a nuclear-free region, as they propose, is possible to happen?
Yes, it is possible, but it requires a resolution of the dispute between Israel and the Palestinians on the one hand, and between Israel and Arab countries around the Israeli neighborhood on the other. It is possible in all regions of the world, including the Middle East, to achieve greater levels of security for all at lower levels of armament. And that should be our aim, step by step. And the Israeli nuclear force should come within that negotiation at the right time.
One other issue which is regularly discussed in Iran by mainly the intellectuals and people who are reform-minded people, and saying that by negotiating with a government, which is, in their view, is not legitimate, is in power through fraudulent election. Basically, you're accepting these, in their view, illegitimate government, and forgetting all about democracy, forgetting all about human rights, and things that you've been, the West is basically saying that they are advocating.
No, I don't believe that Britain, France, and the others are neglecting human rights in Iran. They wish to express their respect for those who are challenging the lack of freedom in Iran and seeking better forms of government. And they wish to see Iran accountable to the international community for the way in which it treats its citizens. And what we have seen since the election by way of suppression violently of peaceful means of expression, whether on the street or in the media, by arrests, by beatings and by killings, is totally intolerable. And the international community will never forget that, in the same way as it does not forget situations of a similar kind that occur elsewhere in the world. But there are, at the same time, there are important questions to be discussed with the Iranian government. Britain is not intervening in Iran's internal affairs and will not do so. So we have no means of determining who our negotiating partner should be. We have to accept the reality that there is a government in control of its territory in Iran, and that that government is accepted sitting in the Iranian seat in the United Nations. We can't, through these necessary discussions about peace and security in the region and more widely, determine who should be the government of Iran. These are two separate questions.
But you yourself, Sir Richard, have been almost categorical about the Iranian election being fraudulent. How do you know?
I have said, and I maintain, that I don't believe the election was fair. I haven't said and don't know who was the winner in real terms if the election had been internationally supervised, like so many elections are around the world. I don't know, and I don't suppose the world will ever know. There were clearly unfair elements to that election, and that should be put right in future.
And that unfair elements, what is it? I mean, where do you see it being unfair in what respect?
Well, the counting of the votes does seem to have been highly suspicious. And whether or not that's true, as I said, would depend on an impartial investigation. And I don't believe there has been one.
Yeah. You mentioned that Britain doesn't interfere in the internal affairs of Iran, but this is not the view that the Iranian leadership is taking. They'd be basically constantly accusing Britain of interfering in the internal affairs, especially after the elections. Mm-hmm. What's your response to that?
Well, Britain has been used, not for the first time, as a scapegoat for internal problems in the country. But the idea that Britain is a mastermind of what happens in Iran may be deeply embedded in the minds of many Iranians, but it is nonetheless a fantasy. The Iranians are in charge of their own destiny and have been for many decades. So to suggest that the British Embassy, for example, was involved in nefarious practices which have given rise to disturbances in Iran is utter nonsense.
But you accept that the animosity towards the Britain has exacerbated basically the venomous words by Ayatollah Khamenei for the Britain being the worst of evils. And also, as you suggested, the arrest of the embassy staff and all that. Something must have triggered that.
Well, what he said about us is not new. If you look back in the history of remarks which the leader of Iran has made about Britain, you will see similar things. There is a tradition since the Iranian Revolution of blaming Britain, without any evidence whatsoever.
Recently, Mr. Ahmadinejad, in an interview with an American channel, it was after the Qom revelation and a criticism that's thrown against Iran by the Gordon Brown and the Sarkozy and Obama. He was asked these questions, and he said that we don't care about what the Britain and France say, I mean, who they are to dictate to us and tell us what to do. Whereas Mr. Obama, it's important for us. It seems that the Britain is being kind of sidelined by the Iranian leadership.
You can't have it both ways. Either we are accused of being the mastermind or the worst of countries, or we're being sidelined. Both can't be true. I believe that Britain has a role to play as a permanent member of the Security Council, and as a country which has worked on this particular problem, the nuclear issue now, since 2003. It is accepted by the Iranian government that we should participate in these talks. And of course, Britain, with its partners, reports regularly to the European Union much larger grouping of countries about what is happening. And that sort of transparency is right and it's fine. But of course we recognize that Iran's main disagreements in the real world of international politics are not with Britain, despite what the leader of Iran may say. These disagreements are with the United States. And if Iran is to improve its position in the world, it should make an agreement with the United States, and the United States is prepared for that. But so far, there is no practical sign that the Iranian government would be willing to go the whole way with the United States. Let us hope that step by step it's possible to create understanding. But it will certainly be something that takes time. But it would, if there were such understandings, facilitate the solution of the problems of the Middle East by ending Iranian support for some extremist elements in Afghanistan and in Iraq. I hope also by ending Iranian interference in the Israeli-Palestinian dispute, interference which takes the form of support for armed groups. So there is a long and important agenda. President Ahmadinejad is quite right, not to mention, of course, the many bilateral disagreements that have been in place, American sanctions since 1979.
Yeah. Sir Richard, you started as British ambassador in Tehran at a very important period of Iranian political history. President Khatami had been elected for the second time. And the reform was the talk of the town, basically. Everybody was talking about it. And how did you find the mood of Iranian for reform? Did you actually think at that period of time that Iran was genuinely going through a drastic change?
I arrived in Iran at the end of 2002 when the movement for reform had already stalled and in some ways been reversed. My own feeling is that after the second victory of President Khatami, there was quite a serious reaction elsewhere in the Iranian system that this movement had to be checked. So in 2003, we saw it increasingly difficult for President Khatami's proposals for constitutional change, for example, to be accepted. Important measures like Iranian signature of the International Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, that became impossible in 2003 and 2004. But throughout this time, it was possible for the British representative to meet the Iranian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, to discuss common problems with the Iranian authorities. And it is a matter of great regret that the atmosphere has got a lot worse after I left.
Yeah, but nevertheless, I mean, you lived through very intense intellectual activities in Iran and media activities. And how do you find the Iranian the intellectuals?
Well, I saw Iran advancing in all fields of endeavor, whether in economic analysis or scientific endeavor. But the difficulty which Iranian intellectuals faced was censorship. Some activities are approved and some are not. And intellectual endeavor flourishes in an atmosphere of freedom, and that did not exist. So newspapers were being closed. It was difficult to get certain opinions expressed on Iranian media. There were problems for filmmakers. There was never a time when I was in Tehran, when intellectual life was able to flourish in the way that it is in other countries.
So how do you see the future of reform in Iran with the current situation?
In the short term, the outlook is unfortunately poor because there is a power struggle going on in Tehran, which has been won by those forces who wish to restrict even further than in the last few years the debate about the future course of Iran, and they wish to deprive those who previously they had approved for being part of the government from having any influence. So it looks to me as though we need to be realistic about the chances of change in Iran in the short term. But long term, maybe the picture is different. All Iranians need to agree. There needs to be peaceful evolution. There needs to be an opportunity for the aspirations of young people who are hopeful about the future to be reflected in the way society and government are organized. There needs to be a liberation of the energies of the Iranian people for economic and social creativity, for new jobs, new ways of working, new ways of owning businesses. And we have to wish the Iranian people, and particularly young people, well as they search for ways forward in the future.
Thank you very much, Sir Richard Dalton, for being the guest of Thank you. Thank you.